Seems to work.
Okay, so for our third talk, I'd like to introduce Pierre Clarambeau, who's going to tell us about some extensions to the geometry of interaction. So here, take it away.
Okay, thanks for the introduction. So this is joint work with Simon Castellan. So in the Popple community, one of our aims is to provide tools to reason formally about, is that an issue? No? To reason formally about program behavior. And our most basic tool for that is, of course, operational semantics. So it comes in all kinds of variants. So you know you have big step semantics, small step semantics, etc. But the common point of most of these basic frameworks is they have very, very little to say about open programs like that. They are not by nature very compositional. Right. So if you have a program like that, x plus y, of course you cannot know to which value this may evaluate if you have no information on x and y. We do have tools that allow us to reason about such programs, and one of them is game semantics. So in a sense, game semantics starts where operational semantics stops. What you're going to observe is the interactive behavior of an open program as it plays with, as it exchanges you know, operations or calls or, and returns with its execution environment. So it's formalized as a two-player game, so you have two agents, player who plays for the program under evaluation, and opponent who plays for the execution environment. And the way it starts is that opponent will play a move, so we call it a move, it's Q for question here, and it's sitting underneath the return time of the program, and the way this is interpreted is this is a request for an output value by the environment. Now the program, assuming plus is computed from left to right, the program will play a move here, a request for a value on X. Now it's opponent's turn to play, who may provide a value. Then we call Y, opponent may give a value, and finally we can return. So of course this is a very naive example, but there is a well-developed theory. This is a denotational semantics. I mean, it gives a Cartesian clause category and so forth, which really fits into the general methodology of denotational semantics. So this is, let's say, traditional style game semantics, but in the past decade or so, there has been a lot of work on another kind of game semantics that I call concurrent game semantics. And now the idea is that you question the assumption that plays or total chronologically ordered sequences of moves. So instead, you replace time by causality. So imagine you want to give a fair representation of the interactive content of a program like that, which has two free variables of unit type and attempts to execute them in parallel. So opponent starts computation again, and what you would like to say is that you really want to start evaluating X and Y completely independently. So this is what we do in this model. And in fact, we draw these little arrows here, which I call immediate causal links. And they are really the edges of the Hasse diagram of a partial order that stands for causality. So then these two calls may terminate, and if they both terminate, then we can terminate the whole computation. And what I want to stress is that here we have a partial order that explains somehow what are the computational events achievable by the program, and for each of those events, what causes may well let us see this behavior. Okay. So again, you know, there's a lot of theory behind that. This gives us the notational model and so on. But for now, I've only described very simple programs. And this framework can tell us things about programs which have more access to more effects or more complicated. And so I will illustrate this with this little program that comes from a language called idealized parallel algol. So now this is a toy programming language that has the advantage of having been studied a lot in the game semantics literature. So we have lots of tools to help us. So it's a concurrent high-order language with shared references, shared memory that comes under the form of natural number references. One peculiarity of the language is that it is called by name, which is a bit strange. I know some people like it. I mean, if you have a language with higher-order effects, of course, you know, this is not very natural, but I guess this is for historical reasons. Anyway, please call me question, give me questions about that at the end of the talk. For now, let's roll with it. And try to think about this little program here, and in particular, the question I want to ask is it possible, can we find the behavior for the free variable here, that makes it so that the read on x at the end returns 1. And naively, you might think that this is not possible because the only one in the source code, knowing that the variables are initialized with 0, the only one appearing in the source code is this. And in order to reach it, you must have already executed this instruction, which is the only thing that writes into x. So one way to find out for sure is to take the semantic brackets and look at the interpretation in concurrent games. And so I will explore one particular play of that. And let me just introduce these little indices, which will help me in addressing the different type components. Okay, so imagine opponent starts computation, okay, with a move here, asking for a value. Then the first thing the program does is that it initializes these two references. But this is local state, so we don't get to actually see that. So the first thing we see in the model is this call to the free variable f, which gives us this move here. Asks for a return value here. Now let's imagine that f calls its argument. So we do this, but as both variables currently hold 0, this does nothing at all. And then we switch to this instruction and we call f again. This is another Q1. Now imagine that f calls its argument again. Now we evaluate this, so we store 1 into y. Okay. But nothing tells us that f acts linearly, and f is perfectly able to call its argument a second time. And if it does so, then it starts another evaluation of this, and now we write 1 into x. And if the f finally returns, then we execute this, and we do get 1 as an output. So to sum up, we can get 1, but causally, in order for us to observe that, we need to have this appearing before. So I think this is what concurrent game semantics compute, and I think this is pretty neat. I mean, it really gives us really precise information about the causal interactive behavior of the program. But to arrive at this diagram, I have appealed to your informal intuition about the operational behavior of this program. And that is not at all what these semantic brackets do. Instead, if you want to prove something like that, what you need to do is to recall that this follows from the interpretation of the lambda calculus in a Cartesian closed category, which is itself obtained as the Kleissley category of a model of intuitionistic linear logic. And so you start by this, and then you start rewriting, replacing syntactic construct by categorical combinators, and you end up with a huge expression, which I don't have the space to write fully, right? And then you are reduced to proving that this diagram is an element of that. So there is nothing fundamentally impossible about that, of course, because the model is perfectly effective, everything is computable, so there seems to be no problem. But we need to remember that here, all the individual bricks of this expression are not functions, they are really strategies. So there are certain kind of partial orders. And this little composition operation, which appears all over the place, is not composition of function. It's composition of strategies, which is much more complicated, right? And so if you want to actually prove something like that, what you would have to do is to provide a similar diagram for all of the individual bricks appearing in this expression, and then somehow put them all together by proving some kind of global acyclicity property, ensuring that somehow they glue back to this diagram. And this is not impossible, but it's simply intractable, and I've not done it, okay, even for this small example. And I think this is one of the obstacles to this semantics being kind of useful in practice. So that's one of the problems we address in this paper. So what we propose to do is we start with the source code, and we first provide a compositional translation. So we transform it into an intermediate representation, which is a kind of graph. It's really a Petri net, so I'll come back to that later. And then this graph representation has a simple operational semantics, a token game, which will really produce operationally the diagram that I started with, or possibly some others, if there are other executions. And then we prove a theorem that tells us that the strategy you obtain denotationally by the interpretation in concurrent game semantics is the same, it coincides with the one that is generated operationally by playing the token game on this intermediate representation. So additionally, we have implemented this. So there is a web application that you can access to and play with online. And if I have time, I will show it quickly later on. So what are the main ideas? How do we do this? So essentially, this puts together two lines of research. One is geometry of interaction, and the other is the notion of Petrinet unfoldings. So geometry of interaction, it's a technique that comes from linear logic. So the idea is you take a program, typically a lambda term, and then you translate it into a proof net in the sense of linear logic. And then you may formulate its evaluation, its execution, by playing a token game where you imagine that there is a token that gets into the net through one of the dangling wires, and then it gets pushed around following simple local rules, and eventually it may output the net, and the place where it outputs the net gives you information about the normal form of the lambda term. So here you see that there's a token that gets in here and traces a path on the net following these rules, and then it outputs here. So this has been developed a lot. There's a whole literature on that. It gives us an abstract machine that allows us to execute programs. It's been a quite active line of work. But for our purposes, we have the problem that there is no clear notion of proof net that would be okay for this language idealized parallel algorithm, right? And also, this simple setting of the original geometry of interaction abstract machine is a bit too simple because there's only one token that works through the net, whereas we have a concurrent language, so we need to be able to talk about several threads that somehow are alive simultaneously. So here, we use for that another formalism, which is Petrinets. So Petrinets are really one of the most central mathematical structures in concurrency theory. They are really important. They are also used outside of outside of computer science. They are used in chemistry, apparently. Anyway, it's very simple. So you have a graph like this, which has two types of nodes. So you have these little rectangles, which are called transitions. And then you have these circles, which are called places. And places are placeholders for tokens. So you can have one or several tokens that sits in a place. So edges go from places to transitions and from transitions to places. So if you have one transition, you can look at all the places that go into this transition. So those are called the preconditions. And all the places that the transition may go to, and those are called the postconditions. And the token game then is very simple. You look at a transition, and then assuming that there is a token in each of the preconditions, you may fire this transition. This will consume one token in each of the preconditions, and this will produce a new token in each of the postconditions. So in this work, we actually use something called colored Petrinets, where the difference is the tokens carry an identity. They carry an element of the parameter set called a set of colors. And when you fire a transition, you also apply a transition function like that, which will transform the colors, okay? So what can you do with Petrinets? You can unfold Petrinets. So imagine you have this this net here. So fork is a transition that is enabled. If you fire it, you end up having two tokens here, which enable A and B that may be fired independently. And once they are both fired, then you can fire this transition joiner. And it can be described by this little partial order. And on this example, it looks like we have not done very much because these diagrams strongly resemble each other. But the difference is, the fundamental difference is that Petrinet is a cyclic structure. It's a finite structure that may have cycles, whereas the partial order may be infinite. And so the situation is really the same as if you have an LTS, say, you may unfold it to an infinite tree. Here, if you have a finite Petrinet, you may unfold it to an infinite partial order, or in general, an event structure, which is a partial order that is additionally equipped with a conflict relation. So this is the structure that we will use for our multi-token machine. But the question is, how can we compositionally transform a program into a Petrinet? So how can we compositionally assemble Petrinet so that it's kind of extracted from the source code? And the main idea for that is that we take Petrinet and we add these new transitions, these red and green transitions, which come from game semantics. So the red transitions are open-end transitions, and the green transitions are player transitions. Open-end transitions have no precondition. The idea is that it's something that comes from the outside world, And player transition have no post-condition because morally you send the token to the outside world. And when you play the token game, the idea is if you play these special transitions, they have side effects. So if you play this transition here, you create these two tokens, but you also have the side effect that you play a move in the game. So this enables these two things, and likewise, if you fire this transition, it has the effect of playing a move in the game. And so as you can see, as gradually you play the token game, you see that the diagram unfolds on the right-hand side just by the side effect of playing these transitions. And this is the idea of how we extract the strategy from the PetriNet. Now finally, how do you form PetriNets from, how do you compose PetriNets? Well, if you have two PetriNets, two of these PetriNets with special transitions that have a compatible interface, then you are able to glue them together and somehow merge the compatible transitions into one internal transition that is no longer part of the external interface. And this gives you sort of a categorical structure that you may use in translating programs into PetriNets. So that's the gist of it. So what we have done is a geometry of interaction multi-token machine for IPA. So this is, in fact, it's quite an active line of work trying to define token machines or multi-token machines for increasingly complex languages. So this is a contribution to that line of work, but we also provide a new methodology because the way we do it is original. And so I think this new methodology may be interesting in other settings to develop multi-token machines or prove them correct by linking them with the game semantics. So as I argued at the beginning, it also gives us a powerful bridge between operational and denotational semantics. And we have implemented this. So if you follow this link, you arrive at a web page like this, where you have a little web application. So if you type in the program, let's try something simple. X in parallel with Y. So this is the example I had at the beginning. You may compute the interpretation and you get the PetriNet here on the right-hand side. And as you play the events here, the transitions, you will see that the partial order appears on the right-hand side. So here we have a call to X, X returns, we have a call to Y, Y returns, and finally the program returns. So this is the same diagram as we had before. But because everything is causal and follows from a causal analysis of the behavior of the program, you can also reverse things and you can undo events, but not necessarily in the same order as you have played them in the start. So you can first undo the call to Y, then undo the call to X. So I think this is a pretty neat way of kind of exploring the interactive behavior of an open program. So here is the other example I had. It's the little program I had from the beginning. So here I've already played the token game and formed the diagram that I had claimed earlier was in the semantics of this program. And so because I was able to reproduce this diagram, by our theorem, it follows that indeed, as I claimed, this is in the denotational semantics in concurrent games. Okay, so I will stop there. Thank you, and if you have any question, I'm happy to answer.
Okay, we have plenty of time for questions, so we'd like to... Okay, Jed.
Jed Gillihini from the University of Cambridge. I was just wondering, so you guys have a notion of sequential composition, which is just, you know, wiring the things together. Is there a notion of tensor product that's just vertically stacking the diagrams, or is it something else?
You mean on these PetriNets?
Yeah.
Yes, it's a... So yes, you can, if you have two PetriNets, you can take the tensor product and you also take the tensor of the interfaces as the way you would expect, really. So in fact, it has a pretty rich structure, which is not quite a category, just because it has no identities. I tried to look up. So semi-category is a category without identities. Okay, good to know. So because in game semantics, the identity is this copycat strategy that forwards tokens left and right. But this is not, if you compose with the identity, it makes a bigger net. because you plug another net that adds a new, like a forwarding step. Yeah. So what you can do is you can unfold the net into a strategy, and then you get back all the equations you expect. But I don't think that you can do, you know, I think on the net, if you wanted to have a category, you wanted copycat to be an identity, you could do that, because you could say that this small forwarding step, I could simplify it because it doesn't do much. So this you can do. But here we have also constructions that correspond to all the things you need to interpret the lambda calculus. So you have a lot more, right? You have, in fact, you have a model, the structure of a model of linear logic. So you have promotion, etc. You have a bound, but this satisfies no equation at all. And this you couldn't get by simply little simplifications. In a sense, that's what ProofNet do. So in ProofNet, you can add enough equations that you get a nice the expected categorical structure. But here, you don't have a nice rewriting theory for this Petri net. So you know, there's no hope you could go very far with that.
Okay. Do we have anyone else with a question? Okay, Jean Chao.
Jean Chao from Yale University. So can you explain a little bit what are the main challenges of a call-by value? Like you naturally choose the call-by name, because you inlining the stack and the parallel composition.
Yeah.
So it sounds like call-by value will impose some severe challenge. Is that right or no?
No, not really. So okay. I've chosen this language because I had a concurrent games model already done for it, and you need a concurrent games model to prove that the multi-token machine is correct. So I would need to build a games model. But then the token machine, I have it on paper. I've not implemented it, but I expect I know how to do call by value. So I don't think this is a very big problem.
I think, okay. Ohad. Sorry to make you run around. treat it like an ice cream cone.
So in game semantics, you can restrict your interaction environment against different kinds of effects.
Yeah.
We have something compatible with the token machine, some fashion tools, how it operates, so you can get the interaction effects better behave semantics.
I mean, you refer to things like innocence and things like that.
So
innocent strategies correspond to pure programs.
Mm-hmm.
What you can do is you can, those would give you nets that have a very, very simple shape.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Essentially, they will just be, you know, like direct connections from open and loop to player moves. So there's a lot of the structure that, the structure of the net you obtain is much simpler if you have pure programs, if you have pure sequential programs, indeed, yes.
I mean, the verification conditions you're going to have on those are going to better, right? If you can reflect the strategic conditions in terms of your finite representation.
But the strategic conditions hold for plays, and here it would not be a condition on the token game, because the token game is for a fixed net, so.
And the actual programs you get out of it. Okay, maybe you can take this offline.
Yeah.
Okay, I think I will exert session chair privilege and ask the last question. So there's a small and very interesting line of work on using game semantics for model checking and much larger literature on model checking Petri nets.
Mm.
Is there any way you can like sort of combine these two?
This is this.
Okay.
So I expect, but you know, this is just wishful thinking. I've not really looked seriously into that, but the point is we have this translation of programs into colored Petri nets, and the colors are infinite because they give you information about occurrences, indexes, etc. I mean, as you would have in normal GUI. But what you can do is maybe with some abstract interpretation techniques, you can, you know, over approximate that and keep everything finite. Then you get a finite Petri net for which you could apply the techniques that have been developed in the model checking community. So I think there's hope for that to give us something, and this is clearly something I want to explore.
Okay, thank you, and let's all give.